see you. And we ran into each other at the Albert Lee concert, by the way, and that was a pretty burning
good
show.
Night. Yeah, it was fun.
I enjoyed last year you played with Albert too.
Right. Albert sat in with my band as a special guest.
Right.
And my band had played that festival like 3 years in a row, so they said, "You can't do it again."
Why not?
They said, "We can't have you every year."
Okay, we're going to call Gary. We're going to
have to talk. Let's make him do it.
Yeah, so. I don't think that's right. Here you have an album that just...
That's wrong.
You have had like a really busy year, it seems.
I've been making a record, and so I haven't been many places. I mean, I've done one-off little shows and clinics and stuff all over the country, but I haven't really gone out for any length of time. But I've been home working on this record, and it's like giving birth when you finish an album. You know, you basically... You know, 6-8 months of worth of work, and that doesn't include the writing and everything that goes in before it. So it was fun, though. It was a real creative process, and I was just thinking about it this morning. You know, back in the day when Mike Bloomfield was alive, mm-hmm. and he was sort of an insomniac, in that when he was working on a project, he couldn't sleep. He was constantly, you know, awake, and he would be, you know, awake 24/7, and they'd have to actually medically put him in the hospital and medically induce him to sleep. So I don't take those kind of drugs like that, but I got to admit, I can relate to that insomnia, because you could be lying in bed at 3 a.m, you wake up and go, you know what? I should play that on sly with my Supro dual tone, and I should actually, you know, modulate to the key of B for that. You know, it would be better, and you know, so you're thinking the music almost 24/7, even in your dreams and your sleep.
And I think there's always that feeling too that maybe you're making decisions, they're etched in stone, they're part of your life's work, and, mm-hmm. and it's like,
yeah.
this is going to live on
yeah.
beyond when you're finished.
Right. You got to think about making a record that is a real snapshot of where you are today, but also it needs to bear repeated listening for, you know, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 100 years. If
right.
you can.
Right. Like so, what we were talking about.
Yeah. yeah.
yeah things endure.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
and it's part of a legacy.
That's
you know?
It. Yeah.
Yeah. So when you do this, do you really like go crazy over like scrutinizing things to the point where, you know, you're really not sure? Even though I'm sure you're confident as a musician, you still are.
Well, you know,
perfectionist, you just, and, you know, the insecurity, like, could I do a better take, even yeah. though this sounds really good? And,
well, there is that. You're always wondering if there's that one better one in you that could be better. And then every once in a while, there's one you do, maybe even a first take or a second take, where you go, that is magic. I can't touch it, you know. And I remember when I was doing the Trading Eights album, and I was working with all those different guys, Joe Bonamassa, Robin Ford, Albert Lee, Rick Vito, Steve Morse, and Scott Henderson. Scott and I didn't track together like a number of the other guys did. Instead, I went to his home studio, and we were working on this solo where we literally traded eights on this particular solo. And every trade he did, I go, God, that was amazing. That's a keeper. And he goes, oh, no, that's just boring old stuff. But it's, you know, fresh to me. So I think that's part of the dilemma, is that everybody... I used a producer who was a buddy of mine, and my engineer is a producer. Everybody in the studio goes, oh man, high fives, you got it. And I'm going, no, that wasn't it. You know, I'm hearing something better and different and more exciting, and mm-hmm. you know, let's move on. Let me try another one. So you're always second guessing yourself, that's for sure.
And at some point you got to say, okay, I'm done.
Yeah, yeah.
Because, you know, the budget's not unlimited, time's
right.
not unlimited, you have
yeah.
other things. You have to
yeah.
sort of just decide, okay, I guess... This mm-hmm. is as good as
yeah.
it's going to get.
It's not like the Eagles where you're doing a song a month. It's more like the Carl Verheyen band where you're doing 3 songs today.
Uh-huh. Yes.
You know what I mean?
Right.
And you
got
to get them done. So.
Yeah, especially when basic tracks, when they're done,
mm-hmm.
it's like
yeah.
everything's based on that.
Yeah.
So
yeah, you got it.
No
exactly.
shaky foundations. You got to really feel like
yeah,
you can build tracks on that.
Right, you do.
Yeah.
So.
Did you track any of it here?
I'm just no, curious. I'm not a home studio guy. I mean, I have the ability to record here, and some mm-hmm. TV work, like the TV show Lost, and even Survivor, maybe, some of those shows, they've brought a laptop over
mm-hmm.
with a good microphone and preamp and sheet music and said, since you're only on 4 cues, we don't need you to come to a 6-hour session at Capitol. We can just come to your house tomorrow and do the guitar overdubs in an hour. You still get paid for all that time, you know,
oh.
which is good. So I'm thrilled. They call it a field recording.
I see.
And so I've got the ability to do that here, even in my own laptop and microphones and stuff like that. But for me, the studio is a really, really important part of my records and my process, because those rooms are tuned, you know. I go to places like Sunset Sound, where, you know, Exile on Main Street, you know, the Houses of the Holy, or Led Zeppelin IV, and let me see, what else, all those Doors records, Hendrix recorded there, you know.
That place has such a vibe. Prince recorded there.
Prince is always in there. Yeah. He likes Studio 3, as do I, and Studio 1, you know, and Van Halen did their first couple records in Studio 2, and so I'm thrilled to go in there because those rooms are so nicely tuned. Those mixing boards, they're like modified API boards that have been just tweaked beyond belief, and they're in such good shape. And the microphone collections, you know, can't touch that.
No, so that's because it goes all the way back to when the, what was that guy, Tootie or whatever?
Oh, yeah, yeah, who you mean?
The Camerata?
Yeah, yeah, the guy that originally owned it. I didn't even meet him. I mean, I came in there, started working there more like in the 80s. Maybe he was still around.
Yeah, I think around then is about time his son Paul or something took over or something like that. But anyways.
I remember doing Police Story or, Police Squad or one of those, there was like three of those police movies, Police Academy. Yeah, I did three of those movies in there, and that was some of my first times in there around 82, 83, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But I remember just going, wow, this place is deep. And then Village Recorders is really heavy,
mm-hmm.
you know, some of the studios, some of the Supertramp stuff and all that Fleetwood Mac and everything that was in there. And so there are rooms that I think really lend themselves to electric and acoustic guitar, you know. And those are the rooms that I want to try to use whenever possible. Now, they're expensive, so the records end up costing me a lot more than what would happen if I used a home studio or whatever. But, mm-hmm. you know, you work your way around it. Like, you can do guitars there, and you can do overdubs, you know, in there, and maybe vocals somewhere else. And you know,
but you don't have to sit there and think 5 years later, you know, down the road, I wish I would have, now it's out there and it could have been this much better. So,
I don't really do any kind of home recording as except for what I call non-broadcast stuff or, you know, when somebody wants to come over and engineer it, you know.
And the demos, do you do any demos at home when you're putting together the basic sketches of how it...
Yeah, a little bit. I demo some things. Some things I don't need to, just write a chart, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty old school. I write everything out by hand and here's a couple of my, you know, new charts here. And, you know, now... I should be using Sibelius and putting them in the computer.
I wasn't going
to
say anything.
And I'm about to. I'm about to figure that out.
What are you going
to
get, like a MIDI guitar now?
I'm going to type it in. Actually, to be quite honest, I've got an intern taking my whole catalog and trying to get it in there for me.
Because he can.
Interns are good.
That's
until they want money.
Well.
So anyway.
Yeah, but they get the credit.
That's right.